Welcome to this online memorial service on behalf of the family of Mary Jean Manning Longenecker. The family and I invite you to celebrate Mary Jean's life. Certainly, grief is appropriate at someone's passing, but there is a time for all things, and we are thankful for her full, faithful, and meaningful life. So today we give thanks and we celebrate Mary Jean and remember her together. Much of today's service is taken from the family graveside service in Tennessee last weekend. The video clips you'll see are taken at the Hillside Cemetery outside one of the churches where Jim and Mary Jean Longenecker served for many years. We hope you will join us in worship and in giving thanks for Mary Jean's life. Listen then to this call to worship from Scripture. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. We gather here in sorrow to say goodbye to one we love. We also gather to comfort one another and look to death not as the end of hope, but to God as the beginning of hope. So let's turn to God, our help and our hope, to seek his face and to hear his words of hope and comfort. Let us pray. O God of grace, you have given us new and living hope in Jesus Christ. We thank you that by dying, Christ destroyed the power of death, and by rising from the grave, opened the way to eternal life. Help us to know that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
So I'll be reading from Psalm 103, select verses. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field, for the wind passes over it and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments.
I'm going to read a couple of things, starting with Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Next is a poem that grandmother liked called, He Leadeth Me. He leadeth me. In pastures green? No, not always. Sometimes he who knoweth best in kindness leadeth me in weary ways where heavy shadows be. Out of the sunshine, warm and soft and bright, out of the sunshine into darkest night. I oft would yield to sorrow and to fright, only for this, I know he holds my hand. So whether led in green or desert land, I trust, although I cannot understand. He leadeth me beside still waters? No, not always so. Oft times the heavy tempests round me blow, and o'er my soul the waves and bellows go. But when the storm beats wildest, and I cry aloud for help, the Master standeth by, and whispers to my soul, lo, it is I. Above the tempest wild I hear him say, beyond the darkness lies the perfect day. In every path of thine I lead the way. So whether on the hilltops high and fair I dwell, or in the sunless valleys where the shadows lie, what matter? He is there. And more than this, where'er the pathway lead, he gives to me no helpless, broken reed, but his own hand, sufficient for my need. So where he leads me, I can safely go, and in the blessed hereafter I shall know why in his wisdom he hath led me so.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever
sections from Ephesians 1, 2 and 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. Having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. But being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places, in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, for whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God.
My grandmother was a well-loved woman, and she loved people so much. It definitely, those two things played off each other very strongly. She loved her husband. She was an amazing helpmeet to him for so many years. And she loved to talk about how she helped him with his finances. That was one story that she just, God had given her that gift for financial help, and she was able to help him with that. And then she loved raising her two wonderful daughters, and she was beyond delighted with the men that they chose to marry, and loved to talk about what wonderful sons-in-law she had. And she also took so much delight in us, her four grandchildren, and those of us who have gotten married. She has just been thrilled to pieces about that, and of course so excited about her great grandson Silas. That was the light of her world for the last year. But beyond just her family, there are so many other people that she just interacted and cared about, and she just had a way of making people feel special when she saw them. When she saw me, she'd say, "Amy, it's you." And then I would say, "Grandmother, how are you doing?" And she would say, "Better now that I'm talking to you." And I've talked to other people who had the same thing. She made them feel like they were the most important person to her. And she loved these people so much. And I think a lot of people know about all the work she did over the past many, many years, helping Granddaddy with visitation when they were married and serving together in several different churches. And then once they retired to Sharon Towers, how they continue this visitation that she just loved so much, going to see people who couldn't leave their rooms, were stuck in healthcare and very ill, and many of these people that she visited had no one else to visit them or got visits once or twice a year. And she would go in and pray with them and talk to them. And so she loved encouraging people, praying with people. It was all so important to her. And it wasn't uncommon when I was talking to her on the phone, I would tell her, "Grandmother, I'm kind of worried about a situation at work." And she'd say, "Well, let's pray about it." And then she would pray right then. And it wasn't an extensive, lengthy prayer, but she just took it right to God. And she loved God's word and used that to encourage other people. And from I've been hearing stories about her time at Good Shepherd, how encouraged people were by her sharing in Bible studies and her comments and her wisdom there. And it's so encouraging to hear all of this. And the interesting thing about all of this is that she had all these wonderful things to offer, and yet she was so aware that it might be worth nothing. And she often worried about whether the things she had done were really worth anything, and whether she had really loved people enough, whether she had really done enough. And at least for those closest to her, she would tell us that she was worried about these things. And so I'm just thinking about her now, and she has gone to heaven where she is with Jesus, and he is weighing her works in the balance. And some of it is gold, and some of it is hay and straw, and it's going to burn up. But the wonderful thing is that she is not relying on her own good works to get there. It is the Lord Jesus Christ who paid for her sins and is taking everything that she did and bringing himself glory through all those things that he did. I'm so thankful that she's in heaven now, and she knows the truth, and she doesn't have to be worried that what she did was not enough, because God used her in wonderful ways. So I'm very thankful for my grandmother.
I want to say just a brief word from Scripture, although as I listen to Amy, it's pretty much a repeat of much of what she said, but I'll say it in my words. I want to read to you again just a few of those verses from Ephesians that we already heard, and then just offer a short reflection on those. This is from Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them." As you can imagine, as a pastor, I officiate at funerals for people who are in all places of faith or no faith sometimes. And sometimes I don't know for sure the faith of the person involved. But there is no doubt in my mind about the faith of Mary Jean or her knowledge of God's grace. She, out of a lifetime of serving people, that, as you've already said, that continued right into Sharon Towers, which just became her mission field, joyfully so. And she would share some of the stories of visiting with folks with me. And as she did with Amy and perhaps some of you, she sometimes would express to me that she wasn't sure she was doing enough. And I wanted to take her seriously and did take her seriously, but in the back of my mind, I said, "Oh my goodness, you are running circles around me and then the kind of outreach and care and evangelism. I mean, you are just a superstar." But I just reminded her of God's grace, and that I thought God was pleased with her and just encouraged her to keep doing what she was doing. And I take that as a sign of active faith. I think when folks do have a real relationship with God through Jesus Christ, it is a normal question to ask, am I doing enough? Am I following in the way I should? And that that's a healthy thing. And we can't get it turned around in a wrong way, but I think she just wanted to be faithful, and certainly she was. I particularly appreciate the second half of those verses I just read because they explain the place of works in a believer's life. It is one of my favorite phrases to talk about. Just going to pause for 1 second. After reminding us that we're saved by grace and that itself is a gift of God, Ephesians says that we are God's workmanship. The word that is translating is poema, from which we also would get the word poem. It is the idea that we are God's works of art. And God is the artist, right? So you see a beautiful work of art and you may admire it, but you recognize that there is something and someone behind that. And Ephesians describes believers as God's poems, God's masterpieces, God's workmanship. And when I think of Mary Jean, that's what I think of, as one of God's works of art. Beautiful to behold in herself, but also reminding me, and I think all who knew her, how great is the one who created her and purposed her to share faith, to share the news of God's grace, to care for all those in Sharon Towers around her, and really over her whole life. So I would just simply add my amen to everything that you all have said today. I give thanks for God's grace in her life, for her faith, all of that, a gift of God, and for the way that God worked and showed his glory in her and through her. Thanks be to God. Thank you. welcome. We are here to honor the memory of Mary Jean Longenecker, beloved mother, grandmother, wife, friend. You just heard from Mary Jean Longenecker's four grandchildren. I must admit, I am as delighted with her grandchildren as she was. I am Mark Dawson. I am married to Mary Jean's oldest daughter, Susan. We were married in that church right there in 1982. We came back 3 years later for Glenn and Ruth's wedding as well. And so my parents-in-law have been a landmark, a part of my life, a constant for nearly 40 years. And so often I have reflected on how my own life is just this train wreck of blessing and grace, so much unmerited mercy and kindness, so much that I have enjoyed that is totally undeserved, and how much I did not deserve my parents-in-law, Hershey and Mary Jean Longenecker. For many years, I wrote to the Reverend and Mrs. Mary Jean Longenecker, letter after letter. And then 10 years ago, that changed to writing to Mary Jean Longenecker. I thought of them and think of them still as together. And isn't that a great name, by the way, Hershey J. Longenecker? I mean, we hear the story of Susan Beers serving as something of a matchmaker between my in-laws. But I have a feeling that she married Dad largely because he had this amazing name. If she had come to him and said, "There's this fine young man named Bill Smith that I'd like you to meet." No, that's not very interesting. Thank you anyway. But there was beauty and color and wonder in both of their lives. I think of them together. And for the last 10 years, she was alone. But now they're together again, and I'm thankful for that. I enjoyed so much patience and kindness and gentleness from them over so many years, so many hours shared. Now, the last time I delivered a eulogy, actually several eulogies, was in 2012. That was a difficult year. 10 people died that I was close to, and it was just a time of turmoil for me personally. I came out of the Great Recession with my ability to make assumptions about the future, gasping for breath and dialing 911. And then after 2012, I just abandoned it for dead entirely. It was like I couldn't assume or take anything for granted anymore at all. And the last 7 years have been wonderful, amazing, prosperous years, and I've regained some of my confidence. But now we're here in 2020, and we're amidst all this chaos and confusion again, and so much uncertainty again. First the virus, and now all of the protests and violence. And so we honor Mary Jean Longenecker in that sad context. We were not allowed to be with her when she died. My wife was wondering if she would ever see her mother again in March. And then we have a funeral that has to be limited. We were able to say goodbye to her on Zoom, on FaceTime, sang hymns to her. And she told me that she loved me over FaceTime. We lost a lot because of the strange year, but I have a feeling that Mary Jean Longenecker would have been fascinated. She would have been interested because she was engaged in life. She knew what was going on around her. Even when she was limited physically, she wanted to participate and be a part. Last November, we celebrated her 90th birthday. Big crowd. She was delighted with her great-grandson, and she asked for great-grandchildren. At her age, she was allowed to do that. She wanted to see the generation to come. October, she joined us in Chicago, and she wanted to see the Art Institute again. We took the L together downtown, saw the Art Institute, went to Millennium Park, went to Adler Planetarium. She was interested in life. She liked rocks. It must be. My grandson likes rocks too, so there is something hereditary there. She liked rocks and geology and fossils. She read a lot, read all the time. She was quoted as saying, "People with very clean houses probably don't like to read." We had a lot of conversations about all sorts of interesting topics. She was an extrovert. She had a ministry of writing letters, of visiting others. That was part of her ministry when she was serving with her husband and ministry in the Presbyterian Church, visiting, meeting people. And then for many years at Sharon Towers, she would go into healthcare and visit and meet with those who were ill. She wrote a lot of letters. I wrote her a lot of letters that helped win her favor. I started writing her letters back in 1981. She served as a teacher for her career, also as a substitute. She loved being a private tutor, helping small children learn to read. She graduated from Wheaton College in 1951 with a degree in Christian education. And those days, I believe Wheaton cost about $1,000 a year, which was a lot of money for a family serving in ministry in West Virginia. So she learned very early on to be careful, to be frugal with her money. She reportedly had two skirts and two blouses, and she could eat about these three bowls of food about this size at every meal. But she worked hard, and she reported later that it was the Wheaton College was the best years of her life. I don't think she missed a single reunion. We went to several reunions with her. She was delighted to return to Wheaton, to come back to a place where she had met the Lord, in fact, and had learned about ministry and service and had grown and made good friends. She was a teacher in Charlotte, North Carolina from 1952 to 1958. Here again, her frugality. She loved to talk about how she didn't have a car, she didn't need one. She rode her bicycle everywhere. She met her husband, Hershey James Longenecker, through the Peniel Bible Camp in Lake Luzerne, New York. And we're told that she was encouraged by an older woman named Susan Beers to talk to this young man, Hershey Longenecker. The two of you seem to be well matched. And well matched in complementary ways, that was mentioned. She was good at finances. She helped her husband get out of debt, and she kept saving consistently. She told me some years back that they could have bought a home rather than living in a manse, but they decided to invest and save for their daughter's education instead. They did take a trip to the Philippines to visit Ruth and Glenn and Amy and Peter. I've heard many stories of an epic journey to California, driving across country for 3 weeks, and how excited she was and how eagerly she planned that event. And Mom and Dad were complimentary in other ways. They moved to Sharon Towers in December of 2003. There was an opening available, and they needed to be ready to move in 7 weeks. So that began a crash campaign for my mother-in-law to sell furniture and to get rid of a lot of belongings that my father-in-law had collected. Now, out of fairness to him, he had a large library, some 2,000 volumes, excellent theological library. He had been selling it off for a while. He had a book dealer in Johnson City who was taking these off and out of print titles off his hands. But I remember going into their basement in the manse right over here, and he had taken over the basement. And I told him, you know, Dad, I've seen angry messes, and I've seen depressing messes, and I've seen terrifying messes. This is a comfortable mess. This is a mess that just says, sit down, relax, and take off your shoes. It's fine. He appreciated that. Mom was not quite as positive about that, perhaps, but they worked together. He actually asked for prayer, and in 7 weeks, they managed to clear out a lot of possessions left over from a lifetime together, moved into Sharon Towers, and there they had all they needed for a number of years. She was loved there. She went out of her way to serve, to show kindness, to bless those around her, including those who were suffering in health care.
We lost Dad in 2010. He had been in hospice for about 9 months. She was with him constantly. And those were blessed days for her because they knew they loved each other and knew they were saving goodbye. And we shared some precious moments with them until we lost Dad. That was 10 years ago. And now we're returning here again to say goodbye. She loved her daughters, she loved her sons-in-law, and she was delighted with us, and I'm happy for that. She had sons-in-law who made their daughters her daughters happy. She had 4 amazing grandchildren. And her life was full and rich, and she made our lives rich too. And now we say goodbye to her, and we say goodbye with thankfulness, remembering a lot of good days and good memories and trips and travels and visits and laughter and adventures. And we give thanks for someone who loved us and who was kind to us and who prayed for us. And we say goodbye to her and we look forward to a reunion, a new morning when we will greet her again.
Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for the life of Mary Jean Longenecker, for her endurance, perseverance, strength, and hope. We give you thanks. For the love of friends and family, we give you thanks. For her desire to share the love and hope of Jesus Christ, caring for neighbors throughout her life, and most recently at Sharon Towers, we give you thanks. For her sense of humor, her love of family, her ability to make you feel special when you were with her, and her deep desire to please you with her life, we give you thanks. We surrender to you things said or done that we wish we could take back. We surrender to you things left unsaid or undone that we wish we could now do. We trust in your forgiveness and grace, and we lay those things at your feet. In a moment of silent prayer, Lord, would you hear anything we need to lay before you? Lord, for what you have revealed to us, your love and grace, your constant presence, your desire for our best, your patience and kindness and persistent love, we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, the fiercest drought and storm. What height of love, what depth of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live.
There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain.
Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who is seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. And then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. And he who overcomes will inherit all this. And I will be his God, and he will be mine. Receive now this benediction. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen.